Good morning. Happy Easter. Welcome to worship at Bamford Chapel and Norden URC, whether you are here in person or watching online. I think we're going to have another beautiful day. The notices are on the service sheet, but there are a few things to highlight. Please support the Big Breakfast, which is in aid of both Rochdale and Haywood food banks, next Saturday, 10 till 12. We say thank you to Joan for creating a wonderful space for Holy Week. Can the young children bring their coats into junior church because they're going outside? And thank you to those who donated to the food banks after the Food for Thought drama. £35 was donated to each food bank. Please join us for coffee through this door on the right. Thank you to Stephen and Co. Do we call you Lifeline still? Thank you to Lifeline for the music. To the tech team. Are you sorted, Addy? Yeah. Well, he said, when I went out, he said, I've got a problem, so it's all right, Daniel. And to Daniel for leading worship. We look forward to what you have to say.
Thank you, Barbara. Good morning. Good morning. Waking people up. Oh, I woke up this morning, I feel like someone had stolen something off me, an hour, but here we're here. Once I turned up to church service, an hour late, but there you go. Anyway, this morning, welcome to Bamford and Norden URC for this Sunday morning Easter Sunday service. And it's my usual practice, as you know now, that I use the PRAY acronym, reminding us that prayer is the air we breathe spiritually. We need to be praying. If we're not praying, it's like holding our breath. How long can you hold your breath for? Not very long, me maybe a minute. So when we're praying, We're letting God's Spirit come in. So we pause to be still, we rejoice and we reflect, we ask and we yield to God's will in our lives, come what may. And we'll be yielding today using communion. I was here on Sunday, on Good Friday, and we did part one of what I'm calling the Black Swan. It's a two-parter, so if you've missed it, go back and catch it on YouTube, or you can just, you know, we'll have a catch-up and you'll be fine doing it here. Part one was set in the Garden of Gethsemane, and it set a somber cliffhanger at the end. And part two, it will be kind of dark as well, but we will keep it light and amusing too. However, it is Easter, and there's only one time I can usually say this. Who's a fan of the film Flash Gordon? Do you remember Brian Blessed, where he goes, God is alive, right? Well, it's Easter, and I apparently have a voice like Brian Blessed, so I can only say this once in the year. Jesus is alive! Hooray! So, let's celebrate the risen Lord today as we sing our first hymn, Jesus Christ is Risen Today.
Thank you.
as we start our time of worship, we begin by pausing to be still, to breathe slowly and to recenter our scattered senses upon the presence of God this Easter Sunday. Please know that today of all days, Jesus is walking with you and accompanies you in your journey through life. The angel tells two of Jesus' disciples visiting the tomb, "You are looking for the Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He has risen. So let's come to God in prayer." Good and gracious God, as the sun holds the planet in orbit, your love holds us close to you. We come to you this Easter time, unsure of how to react. We would like to be loud with our praise, but the mood of Mark's gospel telling of Easter is moody and dark. We live in challenging times where poverty is increasing, people are struggling with the cost of modern life, and many are in turmoil over their mental health. So maybe a more somber Easter is more appropriate. But whatever mood we find ourselves in today, we come to you, Jesus, a man of sorrows who was acquainted with grief. And we come, and you came to set the prisoner free and to bring light to those who live in darkness. So we celebrate your resurrection today, and may it bring new life and new resurrection into our lives. In your name, amen. So this morning, I get started by talking about animals. So what's your favourite animal?
Elephant.
Elephant, brilliant. I've not bought an elephant, I'm afraid. What's your favourite animal? A what?
Otter.
I've not bought an otter either. What's your favourite animal? A monkey. We've got a bunch of monkeys here somewhere, I'm sure, yeah. Right, any more children here? What's your favourite animal?
She said all of them.
All of them, that's good. Any more? Right, okay, right. Any more children? Okay, yes, what's your favourite animal? Sorry? Don't know.
Horse.
I definitely haven't bought a horse. No, I haven't. No. Let's see. Right.
Three
at the back. Okay, right. Coming back. Sorry about the cameras going off for a minute. What's it?
A giraffe.
Have you been?
I just like giraffes.
Okay, giraffe. Giraffe. I might have a giraffe. Okay. What's your favourite animal?
A dog.
I've got a dog, but I've not bought my dog. What's your favourite animal? Dog. Have you got a dog? What's it called? Nasher. Hippo. Pippa, good name. Okay, what's your favourite animal?
A panda.
Wow, I've not bought a panda.
A donkey,
I've definitely not bought a donkey. Sorry?
A tiger,
I might have a tiger somewhere.
Over there,
right, let's have a look, right. Okay, I want to see if I've got the right animal. Okay, what's your favourite animal? A lion. Oh, I've definitely not got a lion. What's your favourite animal?
A cow.
A cat. I thought it was a cow, sorry. Cat. Have you got a cat? Good stuff. Right then, okay. Coming through, sir, sorry. Oh. Right, yeah then. Okay, what's your favourite animal?
A sea lion.
A sea lion. I didn't bring a sea lion, I'm afraid. Okay, right, let me explain, okay. For those of you who know your gospel history, you know that the gospels, each gospel has an animal to represent it. Have you seen that before? For those of you who like to be a bit technical, it's called tetramorph. Greek tetra means four, that's the gospel, and morph means shape, as you know. So we say that, what is it? Get the right one? That's it. So Mark is a lion. Mark's gospel is a lion because the lion is the king of the jungle, and Mark's gospel is telling us that Jesus is king. Luke is using an ox. Now, an ox is like a donkey. Who said donkey as a favorite animal? Good stuff. So that's an animal that does service. It's like it does all the transporting, and it reminds us that Jesus is a servant. Matthew uses a human being, reminding us that Jesus became a human being. It came down to earth. And John's gospel is an eagle who flies high in the air, and he can look at the sun apparently, and he can look down on us from a bird's eye perspective. It reminds us that John's gospel looks down and it sees a different version of Jesus and tells in a different way. Soon we're going to be looking at another animal, which is a black swan. But I bought another animal. Who said their favourite animal was a giraffe? Ha ha. Oh. Meet Ginger. Now, guess what? I think a giraffe can really describe something really good as well. Let me explain why. In the Lord's Prayer, we're told, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Now, a giraffe is a tall animal. Well, bigger than this. Probably sort of. Yeah, almost as big as the church. Oh, yes. So a giraffe, it has its feet on the ground, so its feet on the earth, but its neck is up in the sky, in the heavens. And so sometimes, because sometimes Christians either think they've got to keep their heads in the sky all the time, you know, sort of holier than thou or something like that. And other times we're just walking around on the ground all the time, we forget to look up. We forget that we're called to look to heaven and to earth. So the giraffe reminds us of the words of the Lord's Prayer. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Isn't that good? I like the giraffe. There you go. I've had that for a couple of months. I've been thinking about how to use it. Thanks, Ginger. Right, back you go. Ginger the giraffe. Yeah. So let's continue our time together. We'll pray for the children before they go out. I'm sorry I've caused a bit of chaos and confusion, but today is about chaos and confusion because it's Easter. So let's pray for the children. We're then going to sing our next song, which is Lord of the Dance, which is a classic, and we'll have the collection during the song. So let us pray. Lord, I thank you that this Easter of all times, we are reminded that you came down from heaven to earth. May we just keep our heads in the clouds. May we be inspired by you, Lord. May your spirit fill us. But may we keep our feet solid on the ground, walking the way that you want us to walk. And as our children go into their groups today and receive them a bit later, I ask, Lord, that you just bless the workers who go with them, Lord. In your name, amen. Amen. So we will now have our next song. If you want to dance, please do. I'm standing still. Lord of the Dance.
I am the Lord of the dance, and King, and I lead you home.
Let us pray. Lord, of all days, we can't even attempt to buy our way into heaven, but we just offer ourselves to you afresh, Lord. All of our abilities, all of our resources, whether we've got money or not, we give ourselves to you to serve you this day and for the year going forth. In your name, amen. Now, today of all days, I am deliberately trying to sow chaos and confusion. And there is a point to this. So I have introduced, I think, to you the ancient Christian tradition already that has been recovered in some of our churches. It is the holy high fives. So can we spend a couple of minutes in chaos and confusion, just walking around saying hello to each other? Give a high five if you want, or just shake each other by the hand if you're more of a traditionalist. So let's spend a couple of minutes in family time and chaos and confusion, and then we'll follow by the sharing time. Thank you. Hello. High five. High five. High five. High five. High five. High five. Sorry, I'm a bit of an anarchist today.
It's all right.
Oh yeah, high five, yeah. Don't say hello to you. Hello there, hiya. Sounds like we're on the football terraces now. It's good. So as we slowly just grab a seat to make ourselves comfortable, I'm going to hand over to Andy, the MC, the host with the most, for our sharing time. Where is Andy? Oh, okay, I'm going to do it then. Okay, I'll do it. Do we have a roving microphone? Oh, marvellous. Okay, I think I know what to do. Cool. Talk about chaos and confusion. Sorry. Do it now or later?
Yeah, do it later.
Fine, chaos and confusion, love it. Okay, right, let's carry on. Sorry about that. Right, so let's come together now as we rejoice with the psalm. If we can have the psalm up in a minute, thanks, Addy. Dark Easter clouds gather on the horizon as Jesus, the Son of God, heads towards the cross for Calvary. And God takes delight in rescuing the planet that is on a deathward spiral. So let's get in the mood. Let's join with the ancient and timeless praise of God's people with the words of Psalm 120. And please can I invite you to share and respond with the bold. In my distress, I called to the Lord. I cried to my God for help. From his temple he heard my voice. My cry came before him to his ears. The earth trembled and shook, and the foundations of the mountains shook. They trembled because he was angry. He parted the heavens and came down. Dark clouds were under his feet. He mounted the cherubim and flew. He soared on the wings of the wind. He made darkness his covering, his canopy around him, the dark rain clouds of the sky. So let's continue our time of worship as we sing our next hymn, In Christ Alone.
Solid ground, firm through the fierce trials.
We will now have this morning's reading. Thank you.
The reading today comes from Mark chapter 16, reading verses 1 to 8. It's entitled Jesus Has Risen. When the Sabbath was over, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome brought spices so that they may go to anoint Jesus' body. Very early on the first day of the week, just after sunrise, they were on their way to the tomb, and they asked each other, "Who will roll the stone away from the entrance of the tomb?" But when they looked up, they saw that the stone, which was very large, had been rolled away. As they entered the tomb, they saw a young man dressed in a white robe, sitting on the right side, and they were alarmed. "Don't be alarmed," he said. "You are looking for Jesus the Nazarene, who was crucified. He has risen. He is not here, the place where they laid him. But go, tell his disciples and Peter. He is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." Trembling and bewildered, the women went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Thanks be to God for his word.
Thank you very much. Let's pray. Lord, may the words from my mouth, but so much more importantly, the meditations of our hearts and our minds, be guided by you, Holy Spirit. Amen. Today there's a theme, and it's almost part of the service, of chaos and confusion. We all like to have ordered lives. We like to know where the next paycheck is coming from. We like to know where our kids are at a particular time. We like to know where this is or that is. And if something's gone missing, it can cause a bit of panic. So imagine, if you will, a moment in life where something so unexpected and profound happened, it changes everything you thought you knew. Have you had a moment? First year of university, maybe? Me becoming a Christian? I have to think about that sometime. Yeah, that's a good idea. These are the moments that sociologists, I understand, call black swan events. The black swan, here's one here, is a metaphor that has evolved, mirroring the changing world it seeks to describe. A black swan originally described an impossible or implausible occurrence. For the first 1500 years of life after Jesus' resurrection, most people in Europe thought the black swan was like the phoenix, a mythical beast. And so the metaphor for impossible or implausible occurrences was appropriate. Until 1697, when a black swan was discovered down in Australia. And I was over at Hallford URC, one of our sister churches, and I saw black swan in the lake over there. But more recently, the black swan metaphor lends itself to sudden, unexpected events. Implausible, sudden, unexpected. That, my friends, is maybe how we would describe Jesus' resurrection. Because the black swan metaphor truly lends itself to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. A black swan event is a surprise of such magnitude that it leaves us grappling with a new reality. It is such a seismic shift in the bedrock of our existence. It leaves us trying to find a footing in a new landscape that we no longer recognize. The blend of shock, disbelief, and a surreal detachment from what was once familiar is a testament to the power of the black swan. These events don't discriminate between the public and the private sphere. On the macro level, you could say a black swan exemplified events such as the Twin Towers attack in 2001, Brexit, the pandemic, the war. It feels like we're being pecked to death by these things. And events that ripple onwards from those events, they ripple out, touching the lives of millions. Or on a micro level, the personal level, a black swan can flutter into our life anytime, manifesting itself in a sudden job loss, illness. I remember getting a pacemaker, changed my world. Or the birth of a child, it could be something good. God suddenly comes along, you're happily enjoying your job or retirement, he swoops in on his spirit and tells you you're doing something new. The world changes. But any event is capable of sending shockwaves through the very core of our lives. Has a black swan touched your life recently? And so we come to this morning's reading, which picks up a similar mood to the Garden of Gethsemane reading we had in Friday. And for those who weren't there, I described Gethsemane, I compared it to Mordor, because Jesus was so stressed, so anxious, wrestling, he was sweating tears, and that serene garden, he just was not in a state to enjoy. And it was in Gethsemane where Jesus prayed, "My soul is overwhelmed with sorrow unto the point of death." So let us remind ourselves of the brief backdrop to Jesus' life. For 30 years, he was a carpenter. He could have been a car mechanic. He could have been anything like that. But then he spent 3 years proclaiming the arrival of God's kingdom. And then a few weeks ago, we celebrated on Palm Sunday. Jesus entered Jerusalem to the fanfare and acclaim, seemingly at the height of his popularity. And then a black swan seemed to fly in. And within a week, there's a swift and brutal turn of events as he was arrested, tried, and crucified. His followers were left scattered, their hopes dashed. I can't explain what it was like to be in that situation. I can't imagine it. The depression, the feeling of anger, the feeling of pain, the awareness that your hero's been killed. Are you next? Looking over your shoulder all the time to see if someone's coming with a knife. They went into hiding. The Jesus movement that was going to change the world was seemingly crushed under the boot of the mighty Roman Empire. But in the wake of the chaos and the confusion, a mere handful of people dared to go out and see Jesus. Mary Magdalene, Mary, mother of James, and Salome. The guys were carrying, lads. It was the ladies who went out. The ladies were the ones who kept going. They were prepared to put their heads above the parapets. I don't think we quite realise the death threats that were being faced by them all. They were brave warriors. They were real brave women. And we need to stand up and remember that. But it was in this moment of despair that a whisper was caught in the Easter wind. And those words of Jesus, "I am the resurrection and the life." Though the Easter story is well-trodden ground for many of us, it invites us to pause and to delve deeper, to seek out the nuances and the hidden truth that lies between the underneath the surface of what we think is a familiar story. So let me quickly do a tour of history. We all believe in the afterlife, and the concept of the afterlife evolved significantly over centuries. It was a slow burner, And the Bible provides a roadmap of its evolution. It starts documenting ancestral burials. It was a journey from ancestral burials to what was called Sheol, which is the place where the dead congregate. You'll see that when you read the Psalms. And it's not heaven, it's not hell, it's just a metaphorical place where the death, where the dead gather. And slowly this changed into a belief in metaphorical resurrection. So if you know Ezekiel 37, the Valley of Dry Bones, that was one of the first references to resurrection in the Old Testament. And then as we move in time towards the book of Daniel, which was 200 BC, literal resurrection was starting to enter into people's belief. But it took 1,000 years, maybe more, to get from one to the other. And in Jesus' time, the belief in resurrection was there, but it was far from universally accepted. You could call it a fringe notion, more of a comfort for people in mourning than a guide to live your life by. It was not something you'd stake your life on. You wouldn't die for it. Let me give you another example. I'm trying to think of something that we all live by, whether it's Christians, non-Christians, whatever. And the best I can come up with is the highway code. We all live by it. It saved my life a couple of times. Occasionally it helps us to sue someone when they crash into our car. You're in the wrong, it says on the highway code. Would we die for it? Would any of us die for the highway code? Don't be stupid, Dan. Of course not. That's what it was like with resurrection. Nobody would die for it. It was a fringe belief. And then the black swan of the resurrection unfolded her wings. The crucifixion, while significant, was not the full extent of what transformed the Jesus movement and us today. It was the subsequent quiet claim. The angel's message to those bewildered, brave women. He has risen! That marked the true turning point. This assertion that Jesus had overcome death itself, catalyzing a paradigm shift in belief and practice. You see, what happened was resurrection transformed from a marginal belief to the central tenet of what was going to become the Christian faith. It didn't take 1,000 years. It happened over days. And what was once a fringe belief became the bedrock of the Jesus movement. So this rapid realignment was so unexpected, so compelling, that it inspired a level of conviction and dedication in the early followers that they would face persecution and martyrdom. If you want proof of the resurrection, ask yourself this. Why else would a bunch of broken people who thought they were on the run, avoiding the law, and resurrection was a fringe belief, you kind of quote in funerals maybe or something, why would they suddenly bring it front and center, stick their heads over the parapets, and stand up and say, Jesus is alive? And it happened in days. This was not a gradual thing. Something amazing happened. Something that happened was so fast, so dramatic, it's like the Twin Towers falling. It changed the world. And they were the witnesses, and we read it in our scriptures. So this brings us to a moment of reflection. Shakespeare posited all the world as a stage. And in the drama of our own lives, Who is the central character of your life? Is Jesus merely a historical figure like the early belief in resurrection, which was on the fringe somewhere? Or does he hold the prominent place, center stage, because of the resurrection? As we revisit the imminent aftermath of the resurrection, as depicted in the Gospel of Mark, slide back, that's it, cool. We encounter an event that was stark and dramatic as the events of Gethsemane. The women who discovered the empty tomb, they didn't rejoice. They didn't have a praise party. Mark's Gospel says, as you see at the back, trembling and bewildered, they went out and fled from the tomb. They said nothing to anybody because they were afraid. This authentic, visceral reaction confirms, I believe, the reliability of the text we read, and it serves as an invitation to us to grapple with the implications of the resurrection. Because we are confronted with a question, and it's relevant now as it was back then. Has Jesus' life, death, and resurrection upended our understanding of the world? Is the concept of resurrection merely some abstract spiritual fringe belief or theological tenet, or has it become a transformative force in our lives, inviting Jesus to occupy the center stage of our personal stories? Mark's Gospel originally finished with those words. It throws us a challenge, telling us that the story isn't complete. And we're invited to live our lives in the aftermath of the resurrection, telling the story through our lives. So as we contemplate these questions, let us do so with the gravity and the introspection that they deserve, and I'd say they demand. For the resurrection of Jesus Christ speaks to the core of our being and the direction of our lives. Amen. And so I ask myself, does it feel as if the world has slipped off its axis? Has some sudden event tipped my world in any way, leaving me feeling dazed and confused? Are my nearest and dearest living through life-changing events at the moment? Or am I worried that following Jesus could tip my ordered world out of kilter? Am I trying to keep the redemptive love of God's presence through the resurrection at arm's length, hoping to keep God's grace at bay? And so once again, I pause to be still, to breathe slowly, and to recenter my scattered senses upon the presence of God. Let us come to God with our questions and our prayers. Good and gracious God, we live in a world whose tectonic plates are moving under our feet in more ways than one. Changes of war, changes of governments, fears of food insecurity, rising poverty, or drastic changes to our personal lives. If our lives are being rocked by the tides of chaos, may we find stability through a relationship with your Son, Jesus. Or, like King Canute, we may try to control the tides that lap around our feet, but we don't place our trust in you. So help us now, Lord, to reach out and trust you afresh today. We bring our questions to you in a moment of quiet. We bring situations, friends, or strangers whom we know are facing life-changing events. We bring our own lives to you. We bring to you, dearly beloved people of this church, Ken and Elizabeth, Sheila and Steve, James and Fiona, Elsie, Paul and Zoe, David and Margaret, Alwyn, Maureen. And we pray to you today for our churches and our mission partnership, and especially Bury URC. We realise, Lord, we live in a world of chaos and confusion with dark clouds in the sky, but we take comfort from the words of Psalm 40. God set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. And so we look to the cross at Calvary for one more time, for counsel and comfort, as we sing our next hymn, When I Survey the Wondrous Cross.
Thank you.
Make yourselves comfortable. So before we come together as a family of worshiping God with communion, let's have our sharing time. Is Andy back? Where's Andy? Debbie, do you mind doing this?
No, I do it.
Give my voice a rest. Brilliant, thanks, Judith.
Next Saturday, our son James and his girlfriend Amber are getting married. Ella is going to be a flower girl, and James is page boy and ring bearer. James is getting married. Sorry, yeah. So I think we need a bit of luck and prayers for that. Thank you.
It was very good of Daniel to mention the highway code. Philmon, the refugee who's living with us, passed his driving theory test yesterday.
Go on, Linda, I think you're bursting, aren't you? Go on.
Oh, isn't that lovely? Thank you. So, if I have told most of the world. But my little boy arrived last night from Canada, and I wasn't expecting. I think it's more than a year ago since I've seen him, and I see him on WhatsApp all the time. So I don't think he's that far away. It's only a few thousand miles, isn't it? And then last night at 7:30, there was a knock on the door, and I heard my daughter's voice, and I thought, "Oh, hello. What's she want? She wants us to look after the dog." And then I heard this other voice and went, oh, that's my baby. My 33-year-old baby.
It's Keris's turn. Keris's turn. You've all had a turn. Right, Keris. It's Eleanor's mummy. Yes.
Thank you. So normally I tell you stuff about the girls, but this is about me for a change. I start a new job on Tuesday. No Easter holiday for me because I'm no longer going to be a teacher. I've decided to leave the profession and try my hand at something else. So I've got a job at a housing association in Oldham as a sustainability manager.
Hi, it's Anne. I'd just like to thank Addy and everybody who was involved in the wonderful drama on Good Friday night, and for everybody who's been involved in the Easter preparations in any way. I think everybody has been, either with the breakfast this morning and everything, and Daniel and the services and the drama and Joan and everything, and Monday, Thursday. I'd like to thank everybody who's been involved. But the drama was really, really special, so it's a treat. That there's not a lot of churches can put on something like that, so we should be proud of ourselves, really, I think. Thank you, Addy.
Right, Olivia, go to Julia.
I would like to thank our elder for being so supportive and so caring, and that's Linda Lees.
I have a big Easter egg back at home.
A big Easter egg back at home. I think that's everybody, yeah. Oh, Peter.
Unfortunately, somebody in this room is born on April the 1st, which is tomorrow. Unfortunately, that person happens to be me. So it's my birthday tomorrow.
Happy birthday, Peter, but it's also Pam's birthday tomorrow as well. Oh. So happy birthday, Pam. Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Always good to hear. So as we come to our time of communion, we started our service by pausing to be still. We have rejoiced in our God and we have reflected on Scripture. So we now come to yielding to God's will in our lives, come what may, by sharing the special Easter communion today. We remember the words of the prophet Isaiah, who prophesied the arrival of a suffering servant who would be restoring God's people. And Jesus took those words and allowed them to shape his earthly ministry, and we remember it in communion today. Isaiah wrote, "Surely he took our pain and bore our suffering. Yet we considered him punished by God, stricken by him and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was on him, and by his wounds we are healed." How can anyone not be moved by those words and what Jesus has done for us? And so we come to this communion table to celebrate the new life that Jesus gives us, which is only made possible through resurrection. No resurrection, we wouldn't be here. So from this table comes hope. From this table comes resurrection for us. And from this table comes new life. The Apostle Paul said, "For I received this from the Lord, what I have passed on to you." The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread. And broke it and said, "This is my body, broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the wine and said, "This is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." So whenever you eat this bread and drink from this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. So we will share the bread and the wine we pass around together. Please hold on to it and we will take them together as a family. love it. Communion to Hallelujah by Leonard Cohen. Awesome. Christ's body broken for us to bring new life and inviting us to become part of his body, declaring heaven on earth. And Christ's blood for the forgiveness of sins and new life. And so, my friends, as we come to finish this time together, to wrap up, maybe there's chaos and confusion in our lives and we long for peace. Come to the Lord Jesus, who can give us a firm place to stand in our lives. Or maybe we're doing our best to keep chaos and confusion away. And in doing so, we might not want the Spirit of God fluttering in, upending everything. I say again, the peace you long for comes from Jesus. It's Easter. And I don't know where I'm going to be next year. Next year I might be in a church where there's an older congregation. If I do it one more time, I'm going to give them a heart attack. So, channeling Brian Blessed, let's declare, Jesus is alive! As we sing our last hymn, To Thine Be the Glory. With a blessing. Father God, help us to live this day to the full, being true to you in every way. Jesus Christ, Son of the risen God, help us to live our lives giving ourselves away to others, being kind to everyone we meet. And Holy Spirit, breath of the living God, help us to love the lost, proclaiming Christ in all we do and say. Go in peace, my friends, to love and serve the Lord. And that's enough of me talking. Time for a cup of tea. Amen.